So air travel hacking, I got to ask, what is really air travel hacking? There's so much stuff to talk about. I've been doing it since, I don't know, probably 10 years. And air travel hacking for me is everything from, sneaking away in the lounge, getting free food in the lounge if you want to. It's probably not what I need to do, because I'm trying to get lounge access anyway. But it's also like, if you're getting a certain seat on the airplane, which is usually better than other seats, and on some seats you can actually like physically hack the seat, and even if Lufthansa doesn't sell you a fully flat bed, you can work around your way on the seat, just like put a couple of levers, and suddenly it turns into a fully flat bed, if you know what kind of seat it is. So that's also air travel hacking. Then there's frequent flyer miles, lots and lots of stuff you can do with frequent flyer miles. I'm doing it, but I'm not doing it to the same level that some other guys are doing it, that I know that it's like buying miles for money and then just redeeming ridiculous awards, which is really fun in business and first class, because usually in business and first class you get more bang for your buck if you're doing that instead of compared to economy. Then there's credit card churning, which is essentially mostly done in the US, where you get, when you sign up for a credit card, you get a couple of gifts. Like, even in Germany, every euro I spend, I get a mile from my Free Fire program. Lufthansa miles and more kind of stuff. In the US, when you sign up for a credit card, sometimes you get 50,000 miles. You do that twice, and suddenly you have a free ticket, business class, US to Europe and back. So just for signing up for a free credit card, sometimes there's some deals involved, you have to spend some money, that kind of stuff. And then you have to like terminate the contract, and then there's like people that are doing like 10, 15 credit cards at the same time. And pushing like, their credit cards off. So that's not what I'm going to talk about. But I'm more going to talk about finding cheap fares, how to get around, getting on a flight, but not paying as much as the airlines probably want you to pay for the flight. And in general, just like finding cheaper fares. Bit about myself. I've done voice over IP stuff since 2003, built freenet.de, the voice over IP service that we had there, was pretty nice. Now I'm working since almost 2 years with a small startup in Hamburg doing quality management for voice over IP, looking at all those nice kind of small RTP packets, like 10 million packets a second. You build RTP streams, do quality assessment, and try to sell that to tier 1 carriers, which is apparently working pretty well for us right now. In my spare time, I'm a travel addict. So I should have updated this, because now I'm more close to like 600 flights and 29 times around the globe. Right, I'm doing like more than 100 flights a year. Only been denied entry to the US once, which is kind of nice. But I've done trips like Hamburg to New York on Saturday and back on Sunday, back into work Monday morning. No question asked. I'm doing that. If you want to see the flight maps, openflights.org, it's a pretty nice tool. Just like graphs, statistics on where you actually flying, so that's I'm an addict. As I said, airfare, how do we actually build an airfare? Like if an airline announces they're going to make a sale, what kind of rules are involved, how do we make the fare, how can we figure out, can I actually book this stuff, that kind of thing. How do the reservation systems work, how do we find bugs, and then I'm just going to show one interesting bug, which is usually dubbed the fuel dump, or sometimes the airfare. Should you have any point during the presentation, have any questions, just pretty much ask, throw stuff at me, I don't care. We have the time, I'm gonna take more than now because I have 73 slides. Oh, you already have? Oh my gosh.
Just throw stuff, so.
Yeah. I gotta eat the marshmallows, because before you start throwing bottles or anything, you better throw the marshmallows. Even though they are pink, they might look kind of funny on the video afterwards. Okay, so introduction. First of all, we have service classes. That's the kind of stuff you know, economy, business first. Sometimes you have like products in the middle. That's essentially what's marketed to you as a customer. But internally, you have booking classes. It's dirt cheap economy, flexible economy, and all those different booking classes have different names. In general, F is for first class, C for business class, Y for like full fare economy. M is like also used for economy most of the time, but essentially the entire alphabet is used for different booking classes. Sometimes you can see stuff, if you for instance go on united.com, you can see this, and it kind of gives you an overview on how booked a certain flight is, and if you're trying to book a cheap ticket, you're looking like for towards the right end, if there are more seats available, if the numbers are higher. This means there's nine seats available in full fare first class, so if you're willing to dish out lots of money, you can definitely get a seat in first class. Like discounted
first class, if this was, for instance, like Lufthansa United, there's only 4 seats available. They're not selling 9 seats here just because they believe. They just have to sell 4 seats on the discounted first class, and they would still be able to sell more expensive seats in first class. So they don't want customers to just grab the cheap seats and then fly the plane around all cheap seats. They want to make money. That's where they have different prices. Interesting to know, when we're coming through the fare basis later, the first character of the fare basis always represents this, which is nice, because if you have a fare basis and somebody just messes up the first character, suddenly you get bumped from economy to first class if it happens. Can happen, and it actually does happen. More terminology, I'm going to use this throughout the presentation a couple of times. Operating carrier, marketing carrier, that kind of thing. Operating carrier, obviously, Lufthansa owns a plane, they sell you a ticket on that plane, and they're actually operating the flight. Then it could be a marketing carrier. For instance, if you're looking at KLM, they have like KLM City Hopper, the smaller planes connecting all the smaller airports like Amsterdam or Paris. And it's a regional partner, sometimes outsourced, different country for different regulations, different wages, like Lufthansa had a carrier in Italy because it's way cheaper to operate out of Italy than it is to pay some German wages. But still, it's marketed by KLM, but it's somewhat like a different airline. It's KLM City Hopper, Lufthansa, like Lufthansa Regional, Lufthansa or Augsburg Airways, somewhere. There's dozens and dozens of small airlines, but essentially they're all the same airline. Then we also have codeshare flights. On the transatlantic market, for instance, the Star Alliance, which is like the alliance of the United, Air Canada, US Airways, Lufthansa, they are all selling seats on their system for the other airlines as well. So there's like 10 different flights a day between like Frankfurt and Chicago. And if you go to the Lufthansa site, you don't only just see the Lufthansa flights, but you also see the United flights. And you can also, if the flight times are more convenient to you, just get on that United flight. And usually Lufthansa would sell it as a Lufthansa flight, but in reality it's a United plane that's actually a United crew, but they're just marketing as a codeshare flight. Then we also have terms like plating, issuing, validating carrier. If you have a ticket, for instance, with United and Lufthansa on the same ticket, one of those carriers actually has to issue the ticket. What used to be the paper ticket and what now is like the electronic ticket you have, apply all the rules, collect all the fares, the surcharges and everything. They have to have one carrier issuing the ticket, and that's usually called the validating carrier, because that carrier makes sure that you actually comply with all the rules, and it's also plating the ticket on what's called the ticket stock. Ticket stock is like the ticket number you have, it's like, I don't know, 12 characters, digits or something, and they have a prefix, 3 digits. United, for instance, is 16, American Airlines is 1, Lufthansa is 220, and if you just look at the ticket number, you can see on which carrier's ticket plate the ticket will issue, who actually looked at all the rules and made sure that the ticket is as well. If you now look at one of those tickets, just a random ticket, you can, yeah, looks like it's actually Lufthansa flight out of Hamburg, flight number 1, which is always nice. Unless you look at the boarding time, 5:45. But this morning was 5:15, so it's even worse. But it's a Lufthansa flight. You see Lufthansa flight number 1, but it's ticketed on United ticket stock. So I bought a ticket, probably on the United website, but it contained a Lufthansa flight. It will probably continue on to the US or something. And it also shows the booking class. I mean, it's the economy and it's booking class S, which is one of the cheapest booking classes at that time you could get. And they also show, oh, the same flight that I'm on is also marketed as a codeshare on United with some random flight number. There's lots of people are asking like what the other numbers are. Usually in the upper right corner somewhere you have what's called the sequence number. I was the third guy to actually check in for that flight. Usually you only get those low numbers if you're checking in like 24 hours advance, when the flight opens up for check-in online. If you go to the airport like an hour before the flight and you suddenly see a number like 250 there, you know, 250 people already signed up for that flight. If you see the plane only has 200 seats, you know, oh, there's going to be lots of fun. I mean, if you have status, you can hope for an upgrade. You can also go directly to the car and say, do you need volunteers to take a different flight? I'm happy to take 600 euros just to be somewhere else a day later if you're going back from vacation. I mean, I don't mind spending another day in vacation and money for that. It's interesting to look at the number. If it's just like in the 60s, 80s range, most of the time, the plane doesn't indicate that the plane is full, but sometimes if the number is really, really high, stuff happens, yeah.
So would you recommend arriving just a minute before the official last moment to book your flight, because the chances would be bigger that it's overbooked and they need to offer you an alternative?
Probably don't mean booking, but like checking in for
yeah,
the flight?
In, yeah. Sorry,
yeah. It probably doesn't apply because there's now really strict rules about who's getting the upgrade and who's offered, like, this shows, for instance, senator status, so which is like the second highest, or this the highest Star Line status, but the second highest Lufthansa. But usually that's a pretty good chance, depending on the booking class, to get an upgrade. And if you don't have any status and you show up late, you might just end up getting like the crappy middle seat in the back. So you should at least try to get a seat as soon as possible. And sometimes I'm gambling. I've been pretty lucky gambling, just like canceling my check-in if I see that every single seat is taken. And then just show up and say, oh, I want a seat, and there's no seat. I can show you the tickets later, but you can see how the process actually works. If you don't have status, chances are probably higher that you actually get bumped off the flight because they claim, oh, you've been here too late. Even if just a minute, if they tell you you've been too late, then it's actually your problem because you didn't show up for the flight, as far as their opinion goes. So they just give your seat away.
So if you have status, then it might be useful to turn up in the last minute before the official time.
There are some, usually if you're looking at like domestic flights, often it says, it doesn't change on this ticket, but it says something like, oh, okay, you have to be at the airport, you have to check in 45 minutes before the flight. Because what happens is, especially if you're talking about a remote station where you only have like limited crew doing check-in, and it's the same crew that does check-in where they take your luggage, check you in first, and they also, the same agents also show up at the gate. Mm-hmm. And essentially the flight moves from this regular just check-in procedure to what's called usually gate control, where you have like flight manager and one or two agents working the check-in or the gate, and they can do whatever they want. They're moving people around that they have to, they're bumping people, and
Be nice to them.
Yeah, being nice to them sometimes helps, and sometimes just like, okay, just leave you the information here and do whatever you want to do, and sometimes you just get lucky. I mean, I usually don't try to press my luck on just getting upgrades, but I've been pretty successful last year getting upgrades anyway, so okay, this is a different ticket. It's on United paper. It's just because it's United paper and the background doesn't say anything about how or why or where I booked it. In this case, that's my frequent flyer number here, so that's not the that's the ticket stock. It's again United, and it actually says coupon number 4, so that's the fourth flight on that ticket, because the ticket can have like up to 16 different flights or something. It's multiple. That's the PNR, personal name record. You can just look up your entire itinerary and everything. Also, it's like, again, it's Chicago to Minneapolis. First class for whatever reason. And like senator status maps to LH star G, which is like Star Lines Gold, maps the system, so just like random whatever information. Whatever, I mean, boarding starts 7:34. That's whoever wants to come up with that idea. Whether it's 7:30 or 7:35, but no, 7:34. We're gonna be on time. Austrian Air, that's, for instance, upgrade. They marked an upgrade. I got an upgrade on that one from work. Service class, usually they print it like in Europe. They have this same kind of ticket slot. They actually print a C, meaning, okay, this is a business class ticket. Austrian Air 257, essentially the same information. I didn't check in any luggage. I was the 12th person to check in, just because I checked in the morning when I went to Vienna, and on the way back, I was already checked in for the return flight. And you can also see that I was the ticket was given to me in Vienna by a certain agent. That's something it's sometimes interesting to know. I mean, if anything bad happens to the ticket, they can track down, okay, who actually printed the ticket for you? Who gave it to you? So, not really interesting when people are asking, like, okay, did I check in like 60 tons of luggage or something? It's, no, it's just an agent ID. It's just, don't worry. More tickets. What's interesting about those is you have American Airlines 001. but it's a Lufthansa flight from Frankfurt to Cairo. Lufthansa is part of the Star Alliance, and American Airlines is part of the One World Alliance, which is like totally different programs. There's no legal reason why I should have a ticket on American Airlines ticket stock in the Lufthansa flight. Same Hamburg to Palma de Mallorca, which I'm kind of not so proud of actually going there, to Ballermann and the tourist area, but it's on LAN, which is also South American Airline, part of the One World Alliance. Why would I have a ticket? Lufthansa flight on that. That's also this Zurich to Hamburg, also on US Airways. In this case, for instance, I checked in one piece of luggage weighing 14 kilograms. God knows why it's so much luggage. So the question is, why would I have that? And this is essentially what the fuel lab is about. And if you're seeing tickets from other people and you see like, oh, they have this kind of combination, which is not like the typical numbers, at some point you're going to get used to all those numbers and say, oh, you did something which you're not supposed to do. How did the booking systems evolve? I mean, you've probably seen it in a bad old movie where they have like a seat map at the gate, and they have like small stickers that have the seat numbers, and they really take a sheet of the small stickers, take a sticker and put a sticker on a paper ticket and really give you a seat or something. This is how it all began. But at some point they figured out, okay, we have to do this electronically. Every single airline started doing its own system. It was really expensive, so the bigger airlines said, okay, why don't we join forces, and you, small carrier, you can migrate into my system, and if a travel agent then looks up a flight, somehow the program was a bit biased, and like on the first page it only showed like the flights of the carrier that operated the system, and tried to sell more flights on the main carrier, and wasn't really open-minded about what kind of flight it was offering. Not only the cheapest option or the best option, just somewhat biased to the owner of the system. Then the carriers agreed, okay, it's not a good idea to have this. Let's still join forces. Let's found companies that are kind of independent of all the airlines. They're still funded by the airlines, but just because the airlines are paying the money to take care of everything. Amadeus is probably the most commonly known system. They do lots and lots of air travel stuff. You can also book hotels, rental cars and everything, cruises, everything through them. WorldSpan, Galileo are also big. Depending on which airline you're booking your flights with, they might use a different system. And then there's also smaller companies. Sabre is actually not that small, but there's some like Asian, Japanese, Korean, smaller market systems, which are only really important to the smaller, different markets. But now we have like big systems that have information for pretty much every single airline in one system. So you only have to work with one system to get all the information. Okay, how do we get to a fare? Probably you know the newsletters. I'm just taking examples from Lufthansa here. Every Tuesday, Wednesday, you get an email saying, "Oh, these are the offers that you can book this week." This is like presented in a way that actually an end customer would understand it. This is a PDF that would be sent out to the travel agencies day before, week before, essentially saying the same stuff on a technical level. They're saying, this is from May this year, this is saying, okay, we are from May to June, we are selling tickets to all different sorts of destinations identified by the airport code for different base prices on Lufthansa tickets or Lufthansa or Austrian. Different prices, these are the booking codes, all L and T. This is also the fare basis. So this is, you can go from Germany to all these destinations for this base price, but you also have to comply with all these rules. These are not all rules. This is just general basic rules that you usually have to comply with, like when can I travel? Are there any blackout dates? How long do I have to stay? Can I fly back the same day, like on a business trip, or do I have to stay for a week? There's something called the Sunday rule, which usually is used to distinguish between business fares, where you're like flying out on Monday, flying back on Tuesday. And if you're not on business, usually you would be, or if you're not on a business trip, usually you would be home on the weekend. So if you imply a rule that you have to stay between Saturday and Sunday, from Saturday to Sunday morning, you eventually mask out most of the business travel, because most business travelers would try to be at home Saturday or Sunday. So if you make a rule that says you have to be on the road from Saturday to Sunday, you would only catch tourists. So if you imply a rule, this immediately makes it like a tourist fair. It's not tailored towards business customers unless business customers are gone for more than a week. So that's why they always have or often have those 6-day or Sunday rule paragraphs in there. So if you're a bit flexible on your travels and you're wondering why your ticket is so expensive, try to build in the stay from Sunday, from Saturday to Sunday. Often it does get a bit cheaper just by staying a day extra or just flying out the day before. That's it. If I look at how the same fare that we had here is loaded in the system. This is, I'm using a site called expertflyer.com. It's an easy way to look up inside the Amadeus reservation system on how this stuff looks. You have to pay for access. You can get some of the information for free. Also going to show that and show how to get that information. But this is, I'm just paying like, I don't know, $8 a month or something just to get that information presented nicely because I'm using it daily. So I don't want to spend too much time looking on other sets of information. I just want to go there, have like nice bookmarks and stuff. So we can see that Lufthansa filed an airfare for the €229 from Frankfurt to Dubai, which we should find here. Where's Dubai? Oh, that's DXB, interesting, €199. It's a different fare. The LNPDE whatever fare. And essentially we find the same information here. The fare names both on Austrian and Lufthansa, booking class, price, and the same restrictions that were written out on the previous page on the right side, like when I'm allowed to fly, there's Sunday rules, the amount of days I have to purchase. And using that system, I can also look up like which routes am I allowed to fly, what other rules do apply a bit more. For instance, routing rules. If I want to buy a ticket from Frankfurt to Dubai, obviously I can fly Frankfurt to Dubai, and this says it has to be on either Lufthansa, which is the obvious choice, Austrian, which doesn't fly itself but only has a co-share, or Brussels Airlines, which is also only a co-share. But I could also fly Frankfurt on Lufthansa to, for instance, Hamburg to Vienna, and Vienna to Dubai. So for the same price, I get more flights. If I know the rules, I have to pay like, I don't know, €2 here, €3 here for airport surcharges, but I can extend my routing and I might be able to squeeze in a nice trip like Frankfurt to Hamburg and then a couple of days later down to Vienna, stop in Vienna for a day or two and then off to Dubai, essentially for the same price. It really depends on the rules. Some other additional information like the same fare price, when it's valid, whatever, other kind of stuff. But these are the so-called routing rules, which we have to comply with and which we can use to our advantage to get more bang for our buck. The fare rules are pretty easy. and that's not even all. I guess you can look at notes. Lots and lots of text, which is actually passed by the system. And if the system makes mistakes, you can have fun with it. If it just says, okay, if some condition is given, then this all applies, and somehow that condition doesn't match for whatever reason, that some block doesn't apply, and you can have fun. Technically, what does it say? As I said, you have blackout dates, minimum stay, permitted flights and carriers. Just because it says you can fly between Frankfurt and Dubai doesn't say that you can take any single carrier that's flying there. For instance, about Emirates, there might be some restrictions. Stopovers, are you actually allowed to stop over in Vienna or Hamburg on the way out? Can you get off the plane for a week, or do you have to directly connect? And how much money do I have to pay if I have to cancel my flight? Or if I want to make a change and make a change before or while I'm there? All those things are essentially written down in the fare rules, and usually you can just put it up. But if you go to a regular booking site, even if it's just Expedia or something, or the carrier itself, usually you can just read it in written English, which is usually much easier. Some rules that are in there, it also lists combinations. Can you combine the fare that we've just seen with other fares on the same ticket to make like a combination? There's something called add-ons, which is interesting, or end-on-end. End-on-end, for instance, is I have a fare from A to B, another fare from B to C, and for instance, I'm flying Frankfurt to Dubai, and I want to connect from Dubai to
Mumbai, and I have a different ticket, or the same ticket, different fare from Dubai to Mumbai, and I then can fly back. For instance, I need to do this if Lufthansa wouldn't publish a fare from Frankfurt to Mumbai. If I cannot get there, but I mean, obviously, I can just connect in Dubai and just get on the plane. It works. So if that ticket allows me to add these add-ons, I can just essentially have two different fares, combine them on one ticket, and if I miss my connection in Dubai, it's simply because it's on one ticket, they have to get me on the next flight. So this is an add-on, this happens in the background, often you just don't see it. I believe I have a screenshot where it's actually visible that it did happen automatically. You don't have to worry about this, it's just normal. And then you also have add-ons. Add-ons is, I have a ticket A to B and back to A, and I have this, like a one-way ticket B to C. This becomes interesting afterwards as well, because just, for now, just remember, add-ons permitted is a way to save money. Doesn't add anything if you're just flying Frankfurt-Dubai return, doesn't do any changes to your ticket, but allows you to do some tricks. Taxes, fees, if you look at the ticket, often you see like, oh, I can fly for 99 euros, or the 199 euros to Dubai, and say, oh, that's dirt cheap, I want to do this, and then it's okay, but you have to pay 58 euro fuel surcharge, in this case, this is like a trip to the United States, immigration fee, customs fee, some Irish surcharge, international arrival surcharge. Essentially, oh, you might be using the restroom at the airport, so you should pay for that. September 11th security fee. Oh, we're gonna search you. You better pay for that.
It's not in October.
Facility charge, SSF, the restroom. All sorts of stuff. Sometimes, like United Kingdom is like charging money. Oh. You're doing tourism, and we want to like pay for our schools, so you as a tourist better pay for us, so that you can learn this stuff. But if you look at that, London to Dublin, and this for instance also already combined fare, like it's end-to-end, and New York-Toronto combined, the base fare was 82 euros each direction, and then there's like 60 euros here as a surcharge, another 70 euros here, another 100 euros here, and suddenly from 160 euros I get 470. That's all like hidden surcharges. They're not really hidden, but you don't expect them to be there. So the goal essentially is to get rid of some of the surcharges. Obviously, the obvious way just don't fly through the UK, then you're going to save this, which is a nice way of doing it. If you don't fly to the US, well, you don't have to. You can save the 1.78 euro, but it doesn't give you anything. You want to go there, but I mean, not flying through United Kingdom. Oh, I mean, if I can just start, for instance, in Amsterdam or Vienna, and I don't have to pay that surcharge, I would save 70 euros. It might actually make sense to not start by end in the United Kingdom because I saved that money. So, something to look at. So when you're traveling and you don't have to really start in United Kingdom, just see if you can start somewhere else, and it might actually be cheaper. Questions regarding this stuff or not?
How do you get this information? Is this information based on the ticket?
This is per ticket, so essentially you would go through the booking process, like you go on a regular booking site, I would just use Expedia, Orbitz, whatever. You just search, okay, I want to go from A to B, and list you with all the options. You click on, okay, select this fare, and display you like the fare conditions, cancellation, that's everything. It already checked that you can actually take that fare because you're matching the blackout dates, you're matching the right flight numbers and everything. It already checked that. But you can get these if you put it like, what are the taxes and fees? And usually it's like a pop-up and it kind of displays this information. This is taken from a site called matrix.itasoftware.com. The URL is in the slides as well, which is nice. You cannot book anything on it. But essentially it's a company that writes booking engines. For instance, the Kayak booking engine, kayak.com booking engine is based on their engine. So they have like a demo site that you can use. You cannot book anything, but they have their own written language where you can apply like fare rules and different tricks to do some interesting searches, and they list all the different components, everything you have to pay. You can get lots and lots of information, and you can find it there. You can usually just go to kayak.com and just book it there.
So how reliable is this information, this source?
It's based on the global reservation system.
Okay.
The point is, you've seen all the text. Mm-hmm. If they make a mistake in the interpretation, just because there's like if, else, whatever, and they make a mistake,
it might be that they're showing something different, but essentially that's what we're looking for. But it is, the information is pretty reliable. The problem is, if like updates are being pushed in the system, might be that you're seeing something which isn't there anymore, because it just hasn't been flushed from a cache. But it is reliable.
And the name of the site of the company that provides the booking engines?
That's matrix.itasoftware.com.
ITA.
ITA, yeah. It's in the slides in the appendix. It's a great company. They recently got acquired by Google, and nobody's really knowing which direction is going, and they're using, everything is programmed in Lisp. But, but I mean, it's a great system. I use it a lot. I mean, people fear that it was going away when Google acquired it, but it's still there after like almost a year. So hopefully it's going to stay there for a while. What do low reservation systems look like? It's really hard to get like really good in-depth information on how this stuff works, and everybody is doing it differently. So I try to come up with something like an easy way of looking at it. Essentially what we have is, for instance, Lufthansa says, okay, I want to file it, the offer that we had, Frankfurt to Dubai. What they had is, they have the fare base the same, Frankfurt to Dubai is 199 euros or 229. And they also have all the, they have the base fare with the name, and they have the price combination, Frankfurt Dubai, 199 euros, Frankfurt Mumbai, the other price list. And all these different source destination tuples are tied to a fare basis. And as we've seen, that the fare basis has per destination coupled the Robin rules. How are we allowed to fly? This is all essentially fed by the airlines into the reservation system. Usually, an airline wouldn't just directly feed it into the system, but they have like intermediaries, because we've seen this Amadeus, Galileo, Sabre, all the different systems. It's way too much work for them, so they usually have somebody else helping them, just like sitting as a proxy in between here and pushing the information in different systems. And there's also back channels where they are getting information back, and they, for instance, can see if the competition filed a fare that is now like an euro cheaper than what they have in the system, they can like counter offer and just like, okay, lower the price, and there's way much more involved. But this is essentially what the airlines are doing, and they are loading all the data in the reservation system via the fare database. That's interesting to look at. The inventory that we've seen, the F for first class, C for business, every single flight is in the system for each particular day, like how many available seats are there. And once you book the ticket, you have the so-called PNR, the passenger name record, essentially what's your book ticket with all the information. If you, for instance, do like a Freedom of Information Act, and you try to look up all the information that the DHS has on you, essentially you just get a copy of all the information they had on all the PNRs you had. Lots and lots of hidden stuff you usually don't see, like from which IP address did you come, what kind of web browser did you have, what kind of credit card did you use, all that kind of stuff. It's all stored in here in different fields. Depending on where you actually look at it, you can see some of it, but credit card IP address you usually don't see. You access this reservation system usually through a booking engine. If you're a travel agent, you have more direct access. If you just go to Expedia, it's really indirect. Some other engines, Travelocity, the Matrix IDA software.com, offers a bit more flexibility. You can get more to more functions. And for instance, expertfly.com essentially maps most of the queries you can do from a web page into the relevant GDS functions. That's understood? Good. Now, how can we attack that? obviously, what can go wrong? I mean, I can file the wrong price. It should have been 199 euros, it's 199, it's just, I'm just missing a couple of digits. I mean, if this is a 1 euro fare instead of 100 euros, that can go wrong. There could be logical mistakes in the fare basis. It should have said, do not travel between Christmas and New Year, but it says, okay, you're allowed to travel, and suddenly you can get on cheaper fares, which you shouldn't be allowed to do. Wrong routing is kind of nice. It happened, or does happen quite a lot. It's a bit harder to find, but imagine Lufthansa is flying, for instance, Jakarta to Singapore as an add-on flight that they have in Asia, and they have the traffic rights allowed to do that route. They are selling tickets on that route. But what if the routing rules don't really state that you're only supposed to fly that 1.5 hour flight, but instead you can fly Jakarta, Singapore, Frankfurt, Frankfurt, Singapore? Suddenly, I mean, suddenly 400 euros for a first class ticket doesn't sound like a bad deal, because you're spending 2 days on a plane in first class, and yeah. Relaxed routes, I've been on lots and lots of those tickets where you could have gone on a direct flight or non-stop flight between two cities, but they didn't enforce it, so instead you just picked like 8 different airports on the way and stuff. Take the scenic route. If you're intercollecting frequent flyer miles, you have to rebuild your status or something. That really helps. There was a $150 fare that I jumped on between Minneapolis and Spokane. That's like one daily flight, and you were supposed to take that. Instead, I connected in Minneapolis, Chicago, Charlotte, Phoenix, San Francisco, Seattle, Spokane. Washington, somewhere close to Seattle. And then essentially the same way back as $450 in first class.
Wow.
Talking about the point of sale. Lufthansa, for instance, knows that most of the customers are coming from like Germany. If they are trying to sell tickets for inter-German flights, they know German business guys are going to pay whatever they have to pay to just get on the flight because they want to fly Lufthansa. But if they want to convince somebody from the US to get on the flight, it probably has to be a bit cheaper. So it might be that the same ticket in the US is just cheaper than it is in Europe because they have different inventory, so you can tweak a bit. It always pays off to not just look only at your usual travel site you would go to, but for instance, okay, what would happen if I buy this ticket in Australia? Might get cheaper. Or yes, KLM is pretty nice. If you have KLM tickets, they have like their European offers that they're running like every couple of weeks. They say like 150 euros for pretty much any airport in Europe to any other airport if you're connecting in Amsterdam. And it's pretty cheap, but usually you don't get seats. Well, just go to KLM in the US or Orbitz or XP in the United States and see what they are charging. Sometimes you just get the same, you get the same flights, but way cheaper. So that's interesting, though, but that's not covered in this. And then booking engines. I mean, how many problems can be seen on websites? Everything, so much stuff that can go wrong. PHP, Ruby on Rails, I don't care. Stuff can go wrong. So how would we attack this? I mean, this is kind of complicated, and it's actually behind like two different layers of kind of protection. So the obvious way to exploit this is find bugs in booking engines. Well, this is what I've done. The first time I did it was probably like 4 years ago. There's a company called SkyTours. I just started looking, like getting this like screen scraping, which is kind of semi-legal in Germany. It's like, okay, let's see what I can do, how easy it is. Look at this and just like, okay, it's a nice website. I can select different flights. It shows me different options. It shows co-chairs. But what it doesn't show is, how's this fare constructed? How much of this is really the base fare? How much fuel surcharge? How much other stuff? Which fare is it? I mean, it's supposed to be economy, but nowhere says economy. So you start looking at the source code, and it says, it's yes, whatever fare, so it's S economy. It's in euro, but it's converted to US dollars, but it comes from euros, so everything is supposed to be euros. Conversion rates. No. All sorts of stuff. But it's on client side.
It's hello.
Okay.
You're not supposed to see that.
You don't see it. But I mean, you have like nice little firebug item on your Firefox and suddenly, oh look, $50. I made screenshots, I told SkyTools about this like 4 years ago, said, look, this is broken. Like, yeah, well, we don't see it. And at some point you start, okay, what I mean, I just picked up a nice flight, Frankfurt to Singapore, and Singapore Airlines, like, okay, I'm willing to pay like, probably $1,000 for business class. It's a nice price. I would honestly pay that. And then, yeah, did this, and just like, okay, just, if it doesn't work, I mail them. If it does work, I mail them. So, didn't care. Bought it. They charged my credit card. I got my ticket. I could select my food. I could select my seat and everything. Everything just worked. Like, okay, that's nice. And a week later, they sent me an email saying, oh, we're kind of missing $4,000 from you. Like, yeah, but told you. So you might get away if you're just modifying it a bit, but I mean, I wouldn't do it. And they caught it when they were missing $4,000, but it might be different if you're not doing it that way. that this is still alive, even 4 years afterwards, it's still alive. Just did this. I mean, this is for August 2011. Just before Hack in the Box. Again, but not what I'm really looking for. I was just looking. Okay, if somebody in this system makes an error, somehow the price for the connection that I was looking for must be way cheaper than I expected to be. So I just start screen scraping and search lots and lots of sites. I try to do this automatically because I want to be asleep and I want my program to find fares and deals for me without any interaction. And I don't know what kind of flight I want to go on, because I mean, if I have to get on a flight, I want to make sure that there's absolutely no way that somebody can cancel the ticket up on me. But if I have a couple of days vacation, I would just say, okay, this is, I had like a program that said, these are the dates when I have time and I would go somewhere, and these are the destinations I'd like to go. Just fully mesh this and search for every single destination, every single day, see if you can find an interesting deal, and just brute force all different engines. I started implementing it for lots and lots of engines. Nice ones are like Expedia, because you have Expedia Germany, Expedia France, Great Britain, United States, and it's easy just by changing a bit on the URLs. You can actually have different points of sale, different fares. So much stuff you can just search just by changing a couple of bits in the program. I did that with the Perl module. As I said, huge site, Expedia Orbitz, because if something goes wrong and they issue you a ticket where they are missing $500, most likely they say, oh, it's our mistake, you go fly. But I mean, if you're doing that in a small travel agent and you have like an apprentice working at the travel agency and he made a mistake for $500, he's going to fight as much as he can to get those $500 he's missing, because it's probably coming out of his own pocket. So go after the big sites, because usually they're way better at dealing with this. Then I figured, okay, why should I actually search Expedia and everybody on my own? I could just go to meta search engines, kayak.com, vayama.com, idealo.de. There's so many different sites that are actually looking at all the different sites to begin with. So I just search those. Usually they have like Ajax and dynamic stuff, which makes it a bit more complicated, but the Perl module is pretty good. And I also started searching websites where I know that we had mistakes before, where I hope I can catch more mistakes in the future. Let me just check the time. Yeah, going to be more than an hour.
we can take the other hour, we just...
We saved, yeah. I did it for better part of a year, but it ended up like Expedia, for instance, they are updating their software pretty much once a week. But they're not updating every different country, every point of sale the same week. But it's like, oh, this week we're doing the US. Then Germany is essentially usually most of the time the same week. And the French side is like, oh, it's going to take them at least 2 months to get it updated. Suddenly, instead of like having one piece of code that can deal with like 10 different Expedia sites, you start having like multiple versions for different countries. And it's really, sometimes you find interesting stuff, but usually you have to write the code to actually look for bugs that you already know about. So it doesn't yield the results that I wanted to have it. So screen scraping might be legal, it's lots and lots of work, so what do you think? Okay, let's just go and find the human errors and go up in the global reservation systems and find something more interesting and get around the booking engines. So if you look at the reservation systems, what kind of errors would we expect? Usually there's something that's called in the community error fares or mistake fares. Somebody wanted to type $1,100, but just typed in $110, so that's like 90% savings right there. As I said, relaxed routing, you're supposed to take the direct flight, but nobody prevents you from taking a more scenic route. Combinations of flights, like the add-ons, that kind of stuff. Lots and lots of stuff that can go wrong. It's really, really hard to talk about everything that you can do. There's currently, like this week, there's what's called a, we'll come to that later, that's an open jaw way of saving fuel. Essentially, it's like transatlantic flights to the US for €200 that you can currently do. It's really easy, but it's not covered in this because I'm really just covering one mistake. How would you rate if something is a mistake or something is a good fare? Just as you would do with your supermarket, we say, okay, I'm tracking beer prices. If a beer is like a euro per can every single week, and suddenly it's 70 cents. Oh, that's cheap. So you start inventing metrics for fares or for travel. What is cheap? What is not cheap? What's the difference? And in the frequent flyer community, usually it's cent per mile. You look at how much money do I have to spend to travel a single mile, because if you're collecting frequent flyer miles, miles are worth money, and if you have a metric that really relates directly to money per distance, that comes in really handy. So, cents per mile, it's pretty easy. Frankfurt JFK direct route, I mean, it doesn't take into account that you can might take the scenic route through Asia. 3,800 miles, base fare is $80, so essentially you're paying 2 cents per mile on the base fare. 2 cents per mile is pretty nice for economy. If you're looking at websites, they have like the references like FlyerTalk, MilePoint.com. They most of the time quote the cent per mile even in the subject of the thread or something, just so that you know if it's good or it's bad. But sometimes they're factoring like frequent flyer bonus miles they're getting. They're just factoring in the base fare. Might be different routings involved and or taxes, no taxes. So. Just because the value is really low doesn't really mean it's low for you. It's just for some random corner case where somebody else could fly, it might be low. So as good as KPI is or the metric, it's not perfect. But cents per mile is a really good way. So if you start searching for fares automatically, you just calculate cents per mile and then figure out if it's good or not and if you should have a second look at something. How would you decrease the cent per mile cost? Well, obviously, if I can fly more, because I'm not just flying Frankfurt to Dubai directly, but I'm connecting like Frankfurt and Zurich, I get more money and I fly more miles, but I'm still paying the same amount of money, so the CPM value goes down. What happened in a different, that's kind of broken. This one's broken. There was a deal from British Airways where they wanted to increase the fare from, two different ones. They wanted to increase the fare by $40, and instead of increasing by $40, they set it to $40. It was like a business class fare between like it was New York, London to India and back. Whoa. For $40 base fare, it ended up being like $500, including all the taxes. Well, but for business class, that's not bad.
And you need to take it to India.
British Airways made the news not just because they made the mistake that happens pretty much daily, but just because they said, okay, we're not going to honor this. We're going to cancel all the tickets.
Cool.
And it's, you can take a lawyer. I would usually just say, I mean, in the last couple of weeks, I had two hotel deals canceled up on me. I had a suite in the Hilton in New York for like $30 over New Year's Eve. They said, oh, it was supposed to be like $400. I said, yeah, I can understand. They give you travel credit towards the next day, so it's not bad. And another trip where they said, okay, this is like 75% rebate. You're not supposed to get this. Another flight and say, okay, this. Sometimes you win, sometimes you lose. I don't care. But there's some people that actually take their lawyer out and just say, okay, start suing airlines. Doesn't make any sense from my point of view. So what I did is essentially the same. I used trusted my per module. Look for a website where I can get access to reservation system, at least pass a reservation system for free. I can say it's more around Travelocity. Easy to find. If you look for it, you can just get lots and lots of information on the website that you won't be able to get on like Expedia, Orbitz, or other sites. It's interesting. If you want to figure out where to get information, there's a tool called the KBS tool. It's a couple of guys, they're selling a tool that is essentially just screen scraping free sources on the web for the essentially the same information they're presenting in a nice way, but they're charging money for that tool. So what you can probably do is you can just get a demo account for that tool, or first read about how they're behaving, what they're doing, because from my point of view, they're selling free information for money. But if you want it, you can just fire up TCP dump and look what that tool is doing and just go to the same website, because they are not paying access for money for their access, and you can get it for free. You don't have to pay them if you don't want to. If you want to use it. If you want to spend money, probably, in my opinion, go to expertfly.com. It's like $99 a year. It's totally worth it. Direct access to booking engines, like building up your own travel agency, gets kind of expensive, especially if you're paying per query. Like every time you're querying, costs you money. If you're doing like Like, I'm doing sometimes 20,000 queries a day, even just a cent. I mean, you don't have any travel money left once you found something, because it's just too expensive. To calculate the cents per mile, just to get the distance, I'm using a tool called Great Circle Mapper. It's the standard tool to find like where routes are going and all that kind of stuff. And I'm also using a database to like have comparable data, like, okay, like in a supermarket example, like the beer usually is one euro per can, and this week is 70 cents, so I should alarm because it just got way much cheaper. I use SQLite just because it's easy, it's cheap, I can just move it around between different boxes. I had to do what's called area mapping. Airports are like in different areas, Europe, America, South America, Africa, Asia. Sometimes some fares look a bit misleading if they are within the same area. For instance, fares between Amsterdam and Hamburg, it's such a short flight. The cent per mile value on such a short flight doesn't really reflect the value. So sometimes I try to filter out like intra-European flights just to get the interesting stuff and filter out all the noise that's in there. For that, I have to have a mapping between airport names and the area or the continent they're in. I also need the distance, which can easily go through, get from the Great Circle Map. I just have to do the query once and then store it in the database and then reuse it wherever I want. I want to have a database like the best price per route, like you have for your beer can in your supermarket. If you're like querying multiple supermarkets, what's the cheapest supermarket to go to if you just want to get this type of beer? And I also have, just because I can, a raw listing of all the fares that I've searched, but it's gotten way too many rows. I have like 65 million entries. I have like an SQLite database doesn't perform. Like the idea of, oh, I can just copy this file from one machine to another doesn't really work if it's a couple of gigabytes. So I'm now expiring my data. If you want to have the source code, it's on the website. And the benefit of having SQLite is if you have a graphical client, you can do all sorts of nice queries. Back in that day, I only had 6 million entries because I wasn't doing all the entries. Essentially, you have like all the different sources, Edinburgh, all the different airports, fare bases, airline, price, economy, travel months, all that kind of stuff, and it's a nice tool for SQLite databases. In SQL, you can do all sorts of interesting queries and just show whatever you want to see. Unfortunately, it's gotten so large that on my laptop, I can't do it anymore. This database got too big. What did I find using that? I found an interesting fare from San Francisco to New York to Casablanca to Abu Dhabi and back. If you look at all the prices, it's this is like 1650, 1860, 8000 something, 11000. These are really expensive, and suddenly 170 euros, 170 US dollars. And wow. Oh, if I compare to other destinations, like the Q fare is usually more expensive than K, and it should be in the middle of these, in between those. So obviously somebody is missing a digit here. this has been loaded, can I see it everywhere?
November 4th, no.
April 16th.
April, September,
yeah. It has been updated, so nobody dared to change it. It's really hard to get availability because you have to fly Delta Airlines at least to Casablanca, and then there's either Royal Air Moroccan or Etihad, which is pretty nice. But it's still there. I just checked a couple of days. You can still book it if you want. $170 plus some taxes for the return. Kind of interesting routing. So that's the kind of stuff you can just search and find just by looking at the cents per mile cost. There's some other metrics you can apply, like business or first class, you're willing to spend some more money, or that kind of stuff. So it gets more complicated. If you look at the source code, there's way many more factors involved. There's some fares which claim they are economy, but in reality you're still sitting up front. It's like if you're working like for a US company, US government, or even for a German company, and they're saying, okay, our travel policy is that you have to travel in economy, but you can book your own travel. So the airlines figured that out. Okay, we have so many people who have to fly economy, but how about we make a really, really expensive economy ticket? If you book it, the invoice would still say it's economy, it's just freaking expensive. And the small print in the fare will say, oh, it gives you an immediate update. And those fares are usually called an up fare, like queue up from queue picking class to like first class, that kind of thing. You can search for those, and you have to do more research on how to find those. The program does all that. It's pretty easy, but you have to factor in that some airlines aren't doing this system, other airlines are. Probably just use ExtraFlight, because ExtraFlight says, okay, this is business, this is fast, this is on economy. ExtraFlight does all this stuff for you as well. But you cannot just screen scrap ExtraFlight, because those guys are also paying per query. So if you start doing all the queries, they are probably going to terminate your account.
How would you actually book this flight?
Good question. You would look, in this case, your currency US dollar purchasing city is Toronto, because I'm using Travelocity in Toronto. So I would go to a Canadian website, Expedia Canada, Orbitz Canada, and just, you can try San Francisco to Abu Dhabi, but most likely it's not going to show up as the most convenient connection, because honestly it's not. You can do like multi-stop. I mean, if you're searching San Francisco to Casablanca, they might try to route you through Europe. If you do San Francisco, Casablanca to Abu Dhabi, this might already show up. If not, you type in like, I want to go from San Francisco to New York to Casablanca to Abu Dhabi. It gets kind of tedious on Expedia Orbitz to really punch this in and do all the track. Go to matrix.itasoftware.com and then you can add some fare rules. We can do this afterwards. I can show you how to test the rules. The routing language is really nice. You can essentially say, find me a ticket that goes from this airport, through that airport, through that airport, to any random three airports, to that airport, and back. Wow. And it takes a couple of seconds, minutes, whatever. Then you get the results, and essentially really get the flight numbers, and then you just have to punch that into Orbitz Expedia, and you just pick the flights from their list. You don't care about the prices they're displaying at that point. And then finally, you just say, okay, I'm going to book this. Takes Expedia a couple of seconds, and oh, yeah. They might actually say, oh, the price changed, and this is like the cheap ticket you get, and it's actually the flights you want to get on. So it's booking that kind of stuff. One time I had a ticket around the world for roughly 800 euros on different carriers, and I couldn't find anybody online to book it. So I went to my travel agency in my hometown, printed this out, like, okay, this is what I want to book, and she's like, 800 euros around the world, not going to happen. And it's, okay, we try to book it. He's like, yeah, this is interesting, I'm not sure if it's going to work, and she was fearing that she's going to get what's called an ADM, automated debit note memo, which essentially means this travel agent just issued a ticket where there's some fare components missing. It was supposed to be like 5,000 euros, you only charge the customer 800 euros, so you have to cover the difference. Yeah. So usually I would try to prevent going to a smaller travel agency. Most of them, if they're seeing such a ticket, they're not even willing to issue the tickets. On the internet, there's a couple of travel agencies that are by now known to do this kind of stuff. Some don't care that they're losing license, or some know that they're not using a license because they feel that they're right to do this. But we also know that some of the travel agencies are already known. If you like talk to Lufthansa, they're like, oh, I have this interesting ticket, and like, oh, we know how you booked it. And you know that you shouldn't do this because the travel agency knows that it's not supposed to do this, so we're not having you on this one. You're on your own. Yeah. Like, for instance, if you're doing weird stuff, like I'm doing flying out of Cairo to Frankfurt, to Singapore, Jakarta, that kind of back and forth, suddenly your business class tickets get way cheaper than they're supposed to be. But if you get lost on the way, Lufthansa's less interest in helping you. Because just for looking at the ticket, just figure out they lost 6,000 euros on the ticket, and I got lucky, upgrading my flights in January to first class, so I'm effectively flying first class between Frankfurt, Singapore and back. All I paid was a couple of upgrade vouchers and 600 euros, and also gets me like 45,000 miles, which is pretty nice. But Lufthansa could have sold the same ticket for probably 10,000 euros, so I don't expect them to help me on that, if anything happens. So now we have time for the so-called fueler, which is just one of the cases where you can work the fares even more to your advantage and save even more money. What's a fueler? Just one example. This is actually from 2008, but this one doesn't work, but the same concept works. Hamburg to London Heathrow, to Boston, and back. And some of the ticket is only 224 euros, which is cheap. But there's also a flight in here actually next year, the following year, between Buenos Aires and Cordoba, inside Argentina. In this case, this is British Airways and LAN, the same oneworld alliance, kind of does make sense. But if I look at the fare, $147, which is kind of normal for transatlantic flights, because it also includes the domestic flight, but taxes are only $81. But you'd expect to be taxes to be like $400, $500, $600 in that case. Somehow there's like $400, $500 missing, which makes the price point for this one pretty interesting. Different ticket, Hamburg to New York, 13th February, 14th Sunday, like I said, like Sunday Hamburg to New York, Sunday New York to Hamburg, straight back, driving to work, next Monday morning, and this Los Angeles San Francisco added on a totally different alliance. And this ticket is €170, and also this is missing lots and lots of taxes, only €52 taxes. You expect a couple of million euros right there. So, I mean, €170, I would fly to New York every weekend. I did this kind of trip like 3 times in that year, just because I can. So the fuel dump is essentially using an additional flight that you don't necessarily have to take to somehow make the booking engine, in this case it's Expedia France, forget about some of the fuel. How does it work? The fuel surcharge, as we've seen in the previous slides, is one of the many fuel surcharges. In most cases, it's one that we actually can work on, because, I mean, if you immigrate in the US, you're getting surged, you have to pay. If you're using restroom or not, still you have to pay. And you can only save like €2 on that. But the fuel surcharge is really, really quite a lot of money. And if we can make it, yeah, get rid of at least part of it, we can save some money. Now we come back to the plating or issuing carrier. How the system works is all the fuel surcharges, all the fees, if you're using restroom, immigration, everything, is collected by the carrier that is plating or issuing the ticket. So that carrier has to list all everything the travel agency is supposed to collect from you. If your ticket contains two different fare bases, like we've shown before with the add-ons, like one, in this case, Continental ticket and one on fare basis and one American Airlines fare basis. It could be that if the ticket is ticketed on or plated by American Airlines or validated by American Airlines, is that American Airlines has to collect surcharges from this part of the ticket. If they don't know how to do this, well, they're not charging you. This is exactly what's happening. in this way, Continental Airlines, back in those days, couldn't play tickets which involved American Airlines, but American Airlines could issue tickets which involved parts of Continental. So this automatically means if you're on Expedia at an American Airlines flight, the ticket will always be issued on American Airlines ticket stock. And American Airlines, back in those days, didn't know anything about fuel surcharge, because the way they constructed their fares is that everything was part of this base fare, and they never had the fuel surcharge. So, essentially the idea is, I just call it a forgetful carrier. They just forget to collect some of the surcharges. And American Airlines is pretty good at this, and still is today. The perfect example of how this worked was, if you go to London Heathrow at the airport, they have like different ticket counters where you can buy tickets. You can buy a ticket on British Airways. It would contain base fare, fuel surcharge, all the other fuel surcharges. But you can also go to the American Airlines ticket next door, and they would have a code share on the British Airways flight, and you'd go, hey, I want a ticket on that flight. And they would issue you the same ticket, but because they didn't know anything about the fuel surcharge, they wouldn't collect it. You get the same seat on the same flight, just ticketed on American Airlines stock instead of British Airways, and you never paid the fuel surcharge. Unfortunately, that got changed. I never had the chance to use it myself because I'm not living in the area, but it worked pretty well for lots and lots of people. Now it gets more complicated. The only way that I'm going to talk about is what's usually referred to as the third strike, which is an add-on flight. Essentially, it's a flight that you don't necessarily have to fly. You just add it below the flights you want to take. And it forces the ticket to be issued on that ticket, the carrier plate, and forgets fuel surcharge. That's an interesting way. Another way is doing an open draw, a double open draw, which is, for instance, flying out of Amsterdam to the US, back from the ETS, instead of Amsterdam, you fly to back Vienna, and suddenly, fuel surcharge is gone, at least part of it, most of it. Then there's double open jaws, there's lots and lots of different ways of doing stuff. Just because for time and reason, we can only talk about one, and I'm going to talk about the third strike, because the easiest to reconstruct, and the easiest if you actually want to fly out of Amsterdam, back into Amsterdam, otherwise you always have to connect in Europe or something. It doesn't make so much sense. People are talking about this on different websites. We're talking about this in the open, really saying, okay, you go to that website, LAN.com, you type in this, and then you add Buenos Aires to Cordoba, and all that happened is that lots and lots of websites copied exactly the same information and, killed the deals for all of us. So people started talking about it a bit more hidden, like C1, C2, this is continent, United States to Europe, for round trip with whatever, 30 miler is a keyword for certain so-called third strike flight, one of the flights you would add here at the bottom. LA to San Francisco is one third strike. Buenos Aires to Cordoba was one of the most famous ones. Cape and Beach, I mean, you just refer to that, and then most people that are really interested figure out, okay, what is Cape and Beach? Oh, it could be Bahamas, and okay, what kind of flights can we find on the Bahamas or from like Florida to the Bahamas, which are really cheap. You start looking and you figure that out, and then suddenly everybody in the community is using Cable Beach as the code word for that certain flight that you just have to add to make things happen. Or Windy City to Steelers.
Chicago, Pittsburgh.
Yeah, you know.
Chicago.
It's pretty easy. Like, there's lots and lots of keywords. It's, Pineapple Pork is, guess.
Inner Island. In Hawaii.
Exactly. just for the fun of it, open jaw, unfortunately, doesn't match up. Put on the button. It's one way, it's, I mean, 138 euros plus 44 euros taxes gives you a transatlantic flight for 183 euros. Instead of starting in Hamburg, I started in Brussels. I just had to get to Brussels, and then lots and lots of connecting flights, just collecting miles, and it turns out that this is a sale fare, so this just means the base fare was really, really low. And unfortunately, it doesn't really fit on the slide. Should fix this, but we cannot talk about this just for timing. First strike, as I said, you add additional ticket to your flight just so that the ticket is issued on the wrong ticket stock that forgets the fuel surcharge. Two parts are needed. First of all, you need to find this third strike, which is a really, really cheap flight, usually in a small carrier that doesn't know anything about interlining, like how to collect surcharges from somebody else, and it's like, how's that small Caribbean carrier supposed to know how to send money to American Airlines if they're collecting fuel surcharges for them or something? The smaller the carrier, the better they are. You have to find a suitable third strike flight that's available, and you also have to find a good base fare that you want to fly on, for instance, Europe to the United States and back, that actually allows you to combine it, like the add-ons permitted that we've previously seen, to actually add on that third ticket. How would you do this? For instance, the Pineapple Book, where can I find cheap flights? Hawaii, there's a couple of small islands. This is metrics.itasoftware.com. You just say, okay, departing from, and then there's a button that's sitting here, and you say, okay, please show me nearby airports. I'm willing to fly out of nearby airports. And you just increase the range for nearby, like 300 miles, and it adds lots and lots of airports. And then as a destination, you have an airport which is nearby, you also do the same stuff, 300 miles, add all the airports, press OK, kind of random dates, press search, you get this, and then, oh gosh, I've messed up. But still, you find, oh, 43 euros, flight, interesting, but does show euros, which is bad, so switch to US dollars and say, okay, 59 US dollars at that point was less than 43 euros. And it actually shows a couple of different flights because some of the airlines don't sell tickets in Germany. Because previously, on this one, I selected a sales city, Germany. Some airlines are not selling tickets, which say, is this different? See, the ordering is a bit different. You see that there's small change depending on where you're actually issuing the ticket. But now we have lots and lots of kind of cheap flights, they're not perfectly cheap. Like $39 is probably the cheapest you would ever see, but $59 is pretty okay. You know that from where to where, you just look at the fare rules on ITS, or you just click on the fare and you just see, okay, does it allow add-ons? Okay, does it allow, okay, let's use this. So we found a third strike. How do we now find the base fare that we're going to look at? Heck, I've got my tool. It already shows me a list of lots and lots of interesting flights. For instance, this is a listing like the date when it founded, from LA to Tokyo on all sorts of different airlines. You can actually see that Delta Airlines also meshed like the same fare up here. And you can also see it's Canadian dollars in this case, and it's 2.5 to 3 cents per mile, which is not too bad. On the website, I can look a flight up. LA to Tokyo matches all the rules. It's issued in K, which is a good indication that it's actually one of these fares. And if I add it all up, it's $788. The closer it is, I can actually see if these are the fare bases that we've seen. Actually, it's two different ones, but it's LA to Tokyo that we've seen. It's pretty much like half of this one on one side, and the other one was probably this one. You see like this one. Because in the rules, you can just click on rules and you would see the rules. In the rules it says you can like split this fare in half if you combine it with another valid fare. So you can just like take one route or one rule for the outbound, another one for the inbound. All sorts of surcharges, immigration, customs, whatever, your restroom surcharge, 9/11 surcharge, and fuel surcharge, almost $600.
Is this also from ITA?
This is ITA output, yeah. You would get the same output on Expedia if you like click on fare rules. Usually you see a pop-up showing the same information, but the formatting they have is the best you can get if you're not paying money, especially because you just click on rules and see if you're breaking any rules or what else you can do without breaking the rules. So ITA software, got the link in the back, is probably the best to use. I'm just wondering if I missed anything. How would you book it? I mean, yeah, you find your fare, you go to Orbitz and Expedia, you add your third strike, you issue the ticket, everything is fine, and you don't have to fly that last flight. But I've seen some guys who are like, okay, I want to get those $39 back, and I call them, and suddenly, oh yeah, we made a mistake. You can get the $39 back, but suddenly you owe us $400. doesn't always work. Don't always use the same dates everybody else is using. Like if you see an ad where somebody uses a third strike on a certain day, probably take a different one. Everybody was using those Buenos Aires to Cordoba fares, and I imagine there was like LAN, the airline must have been pretty happy, like, oh, there's like thousands of people booking those tickets. And
we're in the money.
Yeah, and like, oh, we should get a bigger plane, and just like, yeah, so many customers, we sell more seats, and then nobody shows up. Must be weird. Yeah, just choose random dates, just because they're always overbooking, and it's just one customer showing up. Not too bad. But let's continue on this one. We've seen, okay, there's $600 potential that we can save. So we do the math. We had our third strike. Like regular is Canadian base fare that we've seen, couple of surcharges. But the big ticket item is the fuel surcharge. If, in theory, we can save all that, we should get down to $300. But instead, we have to add the third strike. And I just said, well, $59 we've seen. Plus a couple of taxes because we might be using restroom on Hawaii actually twice. So still 60% saving. That's what we can probably hope for. Now let's do it. LA to Tokyo, Tokyo to LA, actually different airport. Nice new, brand new route. Haneda is like the old airport that they now open up again for international flights. It books MK because we already know from ITA that at most days the K fare is available. We add another flight, in this case, I have another one, close to Guam, small flight, also on Continental, that I added. If previously we've seen $128 as base fare, so there's another like $60 or $50 for this flight added here, plus some $300 taxes, gets us to $483 total instead of the $800 that we had before. So that's already some savings, but somehow there's still some money missing here. So we didn't dump all the fuel, as everybody would say. So let's do something different. Let's try a different one. Suddenly the base fare increased, but we're saving on taxes. Gets us down to 400, which is essentially 50% of what the flight was supposed to be. The flight that I added, I masked this out. It's, if you look at the logo, it's really easy to find. Just as I said, where would you search? Caribbean, Pacific Islands, Hawaii. Just guess from where the, that airline is. We can take this offline. It's easy to find. Suddenly you've got the ticket for $400. I mean, this is what essentially fuel dumps are all about. Now we had the fuel dump, but let's look at the routing routes, because if you're looking at this, you're just flying LA to Tokyo, Tokyo to LA, straight back, but what about taking a different route? I mean, this says you can fly LA to Honolulu, to all sorts of small islands on Hawaii, back to Honolulu, to Guam, through some Asian cities, off to Tokyo. Nice little fact, at that time, you could actually get on the brand new ANA 787 Dreamliner that was being test run into Japan on that fare, because this allows you.
So where can we read more about how to interpret this data?
I would use Expert Flyer. It's pretty easy to read. If it's a dash, it means it's a connection. If it's like a slash, it means either or. So it's either whatever, all small island airports on Hawaii. Just take one of those, whereas for an easy one, like LA to Hawaii, Honolulu, that's a connection either on Continental or United Airlines.
Okay, so slash, you can check.
So dash is really connection, and slash is an option A or B, or C or whatever, that's all in there.
Okay.
Also on Flyer Talk, my point, all the links open back, it's pretty much everything is explained.
Okay, cool.
So what you do is, you have like a stop, in this case, that's San Francisco to Osaka, and then Haneda. And you can also get the 787. And essentially, that's like $30 more, just because you might be using the restroom and that kind of stuff in airports. So what we did, instead of paying $800 for the direct flight, you can add like Honolulu and Osaka on the same trip, and only pay like $400. Which is pretty nice. Downsides. Obviously, the airlines might be figuring out what you're doing. I mean, if everybody's talking about this in the open, airlines might figure out that they're actually losing quite a lot of money, because every single ticket that's sold on this, they might lose $400. They might not know that they're losing it, but still they're losing it. As I said, small travel agencies might get caught, and even the big ones. Some might at some point lose the license, but somebody has to pay the difference. If I, as a customer, at least in Germany, have a binding contract, if they got the money from my credit card, I'm supposed to be able to fly on that ticket if they made a mistake. There might be lawsuits, but usually the bigger, like Expedia, the bigger sites, they're just cuffing up the difference and I can still fly. But smaller travel agencies, don't do it, please. They might cancel your ticket. It's called a third strike. You could also put the third strike in the front. You can first fly it. But if you don't show up for that flight, they would cancel the rest of your ticket. So usually you just add it at the end of your ticket and don't care for it. You might check in. If you check in a couple hours before, they might call for your name at the airport and you might delay the flight even if you're not there. So don't try to get the miles. It's probably not worth it. And obviously, you get the best savings if the fuel surcharge is really high, which is, for us, it's pretty good, because between Europe and the US, there's lots and lots of savings to be had, but Europe to Asia, it's a bit worse. There's the fuel surcharge is often included in the base fare, or the fuel surcharge is way lower for whatever reason. What else can we do? Unfortunately, this also has, because the PDF also the solution in there, let me get it to me. There's a fare, for instance, between Europe and United States, and the fare rules have something like this. If you buy this ticket in the US, then your fuel surcharge would be $150. If you buy this in Europe, it's 100 euros. What would you do? I mean, $150 is more than 100 euros, so you would probably say, okay, I'm going to issue it in Europe, but what if, or else, you just buy it in Japan? You're neither paying $150 nor 100 euros, so... works for some KLM fares, especially nice for those here in Netherlands. Just try, KLM has like a Japanese website, you can just do the regular search, just upper right corner, just go Japan, research, and if it's cheaper, just buy it in Japan. There's no easy way, you have to really read the base of the fare rules to catch these small things if there's a mistake in there. But yeah, finding it remotely is way harder than just looking for other typos. Some rules or some fares don't have fixed routes attached to them. They just say you can fly 5,800 miles between those two cities. We don't care how you're getting there as long as you're complying with the other rules, whereas the fares that we've seen have fixed routings. So if you're flying SkyTeam or Oneworld, the other alliances, chances that you're hitting a so-called MPM fare are way higher. If you look it up on Expert Flyer, instead of having like the fixed routing rules that we've just seen, it just says maximum permitted miles between these cities, 5,800 miles, and then you can make your own way. It's a different way of optimizing the routing. If you have, you know how many miles you can spend, and there's some ways to just get more miles and paying a bit more. But if you're seeing MPM fares, don't worry, you can still do all the stuff, but it just works a bit different, but we don't have time for that. As a point of sale tricks, just issue your ticket to Japan to save some of the fuel or get better inventory, but booking it from the US often works. Fare wars is what I really like. Typically right now, the reservation system is only updated every couple of hours, like every 8 hours, like three times a day or something, and less on the weekend. So the airlines, when they are filing their new fares, their new ads, they're trying, especially right before the weekend, to sneak in a say a nice sale fare where they're suddenly cheaper just by a couple of bucks than their competition, because everybody that's booking on the weekend is first going to see their fare and probably is going to book their fare, and the other airlines cannot compete. So the moment some airline sees that some other competition is filing fares, they're usually trying to match the fare. So they only have a few minutes to do the update, and if you look at this, you can see that Delta Airlines try to match the fares that these other guys, United and Continental, they're usually matching the fares, and here they really match the same fare. They have the same price, trying to get their competition. Like if I'm somewhat biased to Delta, I would just buy them Delta because both of them have the same flight and just, for whatever reason, might like Delta a bit more. So they're trying to to sneak in fares as fast as possible if they see that something is up, because if they have to wait for the next update, they probably have like 8, sometimes 16-hour time window where they cannot do any updates, and they're like they're not the cheapest one. So if they have to be fast, they might make mistakes, which is nice, because it works in our favor. And then you have like 8, 16 hours to exploit that bug before they can fix it. Unfortunately, now they're changing to a system where they can do ad hoc updates, which means we have to be faster. But yeah, that's the way how it works. Routing optimization, like avoid United Kingdom, we talked about that. Currency fluctuations also works nice. I usually, when I have more expensive tickets, I always check Australia, because with the economic downturn and everything, exchange rates do change, and sometimes issuing the same ticket in Australia just was cheaper than issuing it in Germany. So every once in a while, just check different countries, because you might save, up to like 100 euros. International fares. So what else can we do? First of all, reasonable disclosure. Most of the stuff you just put in the open. I mean, the stuff that I just found, like the Guam fare to get the Los Angeles Tokyo thing down, I found my own, so I don't have any reasons to not publish it. But I don't want if I want to. But the other one, I knew that somebody else found and used, and this is the other fare is actually used, the third strike. So I'm not going to publish it here, because I don't like that somebody else is going to put that information on a free public website and everybody's booking that and somebody's earning cashback through affiliate links, and that's what's happening right now. So, whatever you publish, be aware that this might be abused, and if it's abused too much, it might not be good for the entire community. Best, do not call the airlines. We had cases where people were reporting on a forum where it's like, yeah, I've seen everybody talking about this, I couldn't figure it out, so I just called the airlines, and they're like, okay, this wasn't supposed to be that cheap, there's like $500 missing, and they are fixing it. So calling the airlines, you kill a deal. I mean, it's okay to call the airline a couple hours before your flight to make sure that you can actually go or something or change your seat, or if like they plug the hole but you still have a better ticket, and then you can call the airline and try to work something out. But don't call the airline while the deal is still active. And if you find something, try to give it back to the community, like publish what you find, publish like interesting third strikes, interesting ways of doing other stuff. There might be different ways of getting around additional surcharges or whatever nice way to get from economy to business class for free. I don't know, if you find anything interesting, well, give back to the community. What else? I mean, I've said Amadeus is not only for flights, it's also valid for cruises. Somebody made a mistake. $2 for a cruise. Same with the hotel. This is supposed to be $1,100 ended up being $50. They actually honored it. It would be next January on Bali, the holiday inn on Bali. It's supposed to be pretty nice. So $50 instead of $1,000. Unfortunately, I had to cancel it. But it's just like usually, I'm still on Bali, but I'm in a different place. I'm not there for 5 days. But it's just something, if you see something like that, you just buy it. Because, I mean, either you can cancel it, and these all came with free cancellation. You just jump on it, and, think about it later. It's like, okay, was it really a good idea to book it? But if you see this, last time this was booked 5 seconds ago, and currently there's 223 people looking at this. you better be fast. Just book it. And if you don't need it, then why cancel it? And in most cases, where they figure out that they're losing lots and lots of money every single night, they would usually email you or call you and say, look, there's an error. Are you willing to cancel your ticket? We might give you travel credits towards a different stay or something. And if I really want to stay on this case, so many other people thought it out. They were actually already staying there on that place. They got the $10 deal. And you can just relate. I know that somebody else got it, and otherwise I would just, cancel it. I don't care. But if I can get it, I mean, for $50, it's a heck of a deal.
Heck.
Yeah.
See what you do there.
Yeah, SSN references. Lots of other websites you can get more information on. Especially on Flyer Talk. The mileage run, what's called the mileage run deals subforum. There's lots and lots of information, but you might have to read quite a lot. So I recommend first going to milepoint.com. It's a similar website. It's a bit younger. It's been like a year or so old. And it's less information. Most of it's still valid because it's so fast-paced. It's easier to read, easier to digest. And then I recommend IPA software and expert flyer if you're really interested. $10 a month is really worth it. Summary, well, it's lots of fun. get to travel to all those places you never know you could go. I just booked a ticket to Palau after Hack in the Box, but they just recently canceled it. It was supposed to be a travel agency discount, 75% discount, so $500 New York to Seoul and Seoul to Palau in the Pacific, just east of the Philippines, nice dive spots and everything. Up there on the A380 from Korean Air and back for $500, was targeted towards travel agencies. They got a 75% discount, but for whatever reason ended up on Expedia and Orbitz. We just booked it, and only like 2 weeks ago, Korean Air figured out that they're now people are just like making their seat reservations, and the first people are traveling the next couple of weeks, and they figured out, oh, this is bad. We should have charged them $1,500 more. They canceled all the tickets, and currently there's people are thinking about suing Korean Airlines for doing what they did. What? And I said, well, just give me my money back. And Korean Air offered me a $200 travel credit. And it's like, okay, I won't use it because I have to fly out of the US, and Korean Air usually is more expensive than other airlines. So, well, sometimes you lose, but it's still fun. And it's going to be more and more fun now that the updates are going to be way much quicker. We have to be quicker finding stuff because airlines can fix stuff way quicker. 2 years ago, I was able to buy two nice aerofares within 8 hours. And while I was in the process of booking the third one, you could actually see on all the websites that the fare was like being canceled and was disappearing. So you're like, okay, it disappeared from this box. So you just switch from that airline to a different airline, try to issue the same ticket on a different airline. And while you're in the process, you see, oh gosh, the fare increased by $100 and it's going, yeah, it's nice, but yeah. That's about it.
What's GDS?
Any questions?
What's GDS?
Global distribution.
Global distribution system, or computer reservation system. It's like all the different airlines, yeah, all the fares, the media in the global database, and then like Expedia audits the all access database to see what kind of fares actually work.
So when do we start
travel agency together? It's kind of expensive, and you still have to pay per query. So that's why we didn't do it. But how do I get it to full screen? This is, for instance, what's currently bookable. It's in German, but it's leaving next February and coming back. It's a weekend trip, Milano through to Toronto and back from Toronto to Vienna, 200 euros. You can book this right now. Anybody's interested, Amsterdam is. Amsterdam and back to Vienna, actually on Swiss and Canada, which I like way more than Alitalia, $380. If anybody's interested, we can just do some random searching. But I mean, this is really just like bookable right now. If anybody's willing to fly Alitalia, I don't recommend it.
No, Alitalia's got like
last week
ever
of May from the States to Amsterdam. Is this loss?
What got you started in air travel hacking? How did you get into this?
Yeah. I was working in the US for a year and I started traveling back and forth like every couple of weeks. And first time I landed in Atlanta, got stuck in immigration, second day immigration, because I slid a visa waiver from 9/11 in my passport. Ended up in interrogation and then figured out, okay, I'm just gonna, instead of landing and clearing immigration in Atlanta, I'm just gonna fly to other East Coast cities and then connect inside, like domestically to Atlanta, and then figure out all the different routes. And at some point, Delta sent me their silver medallion card, like, oh, you know, you're a frequent traveler, and you get this luggage tag, and you get some privilege, like, okay, what the heck is... Well, they only told me, like, you get this, it's like, okay, yeah, whatever. And then I was back home in Germany, the luggage tag didn't arrive, or the plastic card, it wasn't in my home in Atlanta. I was like, okay, just emailed them, I was like, I'm supposed to get this card, but it's not here, so what's going on? Like, yeah, we kind of messed up, we're not sending you another one, because we've seen... that you're gonna get gold status in a week. Like, okay, then you have to send me this, and with gold status, suddenly you get lounge access, you get upgrades, and that kind of stuff. So it gets interesting. Stop flying so much, and then had all those miles lying around. So, okay, how do I get the most out of the miles? And ended up going on vacation for like 2 years just on those miles. And then started building up status again, and now it's like Lufthansa, it's actually... status is valid for 2 years. Usually status is valid for like one calendar year or one rolling year. So if you qualify in April, status is valid for next April. But on Lufthansa, it's actually valid for 2 years. So this year, I don't have to requalify. But next year, I know that I've requalified, so I'm taking trips that I probably wouldn't take otherwise. Just like, yeah, going to the US and back as a day trip. Just I need the miles. I probably don't need them, but I want to have them. Or like, yeah, going, doing like Cairo to Jakarta instead of trying to Singapore, that's just because it gets more miles and it's cheaper. And it's, it's an addiction. It's a nice hobby. The problem is, at some point it's like, oh, you're supposed to go on a business trip to Vienna, you're supposed to go there, and it's like, oh, it becomes normal. So you start doing stuff that you start going places where most people would never dream of doing. Like, who would travel to Romania for a weekend? Just for pleasure, yeah. Or Chernobyl, Kiev. Eastern European countries. I mean, most people, it's like, well, where have you been on a weekend? It's like, yeah, I've been to Spain, or I've been to Romania, I've been to Chernobyl. It's like, why the heck would you do that? Like, why not?
Because you can,
but,
yeah.
Yeah, it changes your perspective on travel, and that's what I like, yeah. Cool. Yeah. Any other questions?
How often do you see familiar faces on the trip?
See, this morning I actually had the same security guy that I had yesterday morning. Usually, there's kind of like the different frequent flyer communities. They have like different luggage tags, like bright yellow flyer talk luggage tag, or blue mile point luggage tag, and this. You actually start going on the same trip with friends. Like, if I find something interesting, you just make a screenshot, show the screenshot to friends, say, yeah, do you want to get on this as well? And then suddenly you're like 10 people going on the same trip. There's, for instance, like the last Lufthansa Italia flight, there was like 40 people on the same flight. There was Frankfurt to Genoa. We were, I think, 25 people, and we paid like 25 euros for a ticket, and they upgraded me to business class on the way out. I was like,
yeah, nice.
So, yeah, once you fly, you just go just because you can. And then if you tell people about cheap flights, they would just come along, and they would just tag along, and suddenly you... if I have to go on weekend trips, usually you don't meet anybody. Then there's so many gatherings where we say, oh, that's an interesting fair, and like lots and lots of people from the US are all flying to Europe, and they're meeting like Thanksgiving is a typical weekend. In January, we're all meeting in Singapore, because typically the Americans have to re-qualify for their status next year, and they're trying to build up record miles, and the fares to Singapore used to be pretty cheap. Nowadays, everybody's booking award tickets in first and business class just to get there, just to meet the people instead of building up miles. But I have to re-qualify, so I actually paid for my ticket. And it's, I would guess there's going to be like 40, 50 people there. So, but yeah, once a week you meet somebody, you know, on a flight.
Can you tell us what stuff that went wrong, and the place where you got stuck, or where you couldn't fly back or something? I mean, this all sounds a bit too good to be true, so where does it go wrong?
it goes wrong if you're combining tickets, which you're probably not supposed to combine. I mean, I was denied access to the United States once on Guam, because I had a trip. I was invited to a conference in South Korea, and then spent frequent flyer miles on a trip from South Korea through Guam to the Marshall Islands, like Bikini Atoll. There's like lots of this plane called the Island Hopper. It's essentially a Continental 737 domestic plane that hops all the way from Honolulu through all the small different islands all the way to Guam.
Wow.
And because it's like a domestic flight, it's like 30,000 frequent flyer miles in business class plus some $35 taxes. Just had to do it, and my boss told me, okay, but you have to be in San Francisco for a meeting the same week. It's okay, the only way to do it would be to fly Hamburg, Frankfurt, Seoul, San Francisco straight. Checked in my luggage, said, okay, look, I have two different tickets, please check my luggage. And she's like, what the fuck are you doing? You can just go on that flight, you'll be in San Francisco in 12 hours, but instead you're going the other direction. It takes you 2 days. And she mislabeled my luggage because she thought San Francisco would be SAN, which is San Diego. So I caught that, so my luggage arrived. But on the way back, I left San Francisco, crossed the dateline, got into Seoul, and was supposed to connect to Guam, which is US territories, and the same laws apply. So you're not supposed to re-enter the United States within 24 hours. There's some stuff like if you're going to Tijuana, you're actually emigrating, you just can go back in. But Guam, I claim that, look, it's a deadline, it's 24 hours. I mean, it's a totally different day today. But they didn't buy that. They called my name, they stopped me in Seoul, and they said, okay, go to a hotel. Because I was flying business class, they were like, okay, you're a business class customer, they're treating you well, you're paying for your hotel, which is kind of nice. And then the next morning I showed up and said, look, I want to get on the plane, I want to go to Guam. And they said, no, you're a citizen, you have to go on a US carrier. It's like, what the heck, who says that I'm not a US citizen, and who says they have to go on a US carrier? But they denied me access on getting on that plane for whatever reason on the direct Korean airline.
So it's not the United States that denied you entry; it was the airline that denied you entry.
It's the airline, and it's for instance in most countries you have actually DHS working in foreign countries like as advisors. They're not working as DHS people, and there's rules. For instance, if Lufthansa or any airline allows somebody to fly to the US and they fail to get in the country because they don't get through immigration, the airline not only has to take them back on the next possible flight, but they also have to pay $3,000.
Right, but
so that's why the other airlines, even already in their home country,
verify that you have a good chance of actually getting in, through immigration in the US.
But if they made you wait a day, why was it a problem?
It was more than 24 hours, and I mean, on the work clock, and I don't know why, and I want to go. I mean, yeah, there is probably a rule I didn't know. Yeah, it's.
Yeah, no, I'm just curious if they had any logic, or if it was just like, you know, desk clerk being like, I don't know what to do, I'm going to.
They were just, somebody just said, and it was Korean Air, like the Korean Air personal assistant saying, oh, Mr. Chun, sorry, you can't travel, and she was really apologizing all the time, getting me the hotel room and everything. They set me up in the hotel, rebooked me on the next day, and the next day was like Delta Airlines, because I had a ticket booked through Delta Airlines. And they said, no, you can't go, and they rebooked me through Tokyo, because then I could get on a Northwest flight the following day. So it essentially took me 2 days to get to Guam, but...
Doesn't sound like it actually went wrong, though.
Mm-hmm. 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 I can show you this. Let me just see where I have it. I booked, for instance, this one. It's LA to Melbourne, Australia, Sydney, back to LA. I was supposed to be on the Qantas A380, 180 euros, which is nice. So like, this is like 12, 13-hour flights. And it was end of 2008. Qantas was supposed to have the A380 by that date. They got it a bit late. It was still running on the training schedule, and the A380 didn't go on the date. I mean, it would have been nice to be on an A380 within the like first week, but yeah, couldn't get on that. Stuff that really went wrong. Honestly, it certainly happens. Most time the airlines actually mess up. This one is like an A380 fare that was fine, and they were missing some regulation that said it has to be on an A380. And you just look it up closer, you can see that it's actually on a 747 or 777s connecting in Bangkok and Singapore. And it's actually like London to Asia to Sydney. For a total of 360 euros. And it was supposed to be a different fare. I don't know how they messed this one up. Sometimes, I mean, Hamburg, Vienna to Toronto and back, 600 euros regular fare, but ended up being the most expensive business class. So, nice. Usually this ticket would have been a couple thousand euros. Because it's J, it's not just business class, it's the most expensive business class you can buy.
A fully refundable business class, yeah.
Are you trucking a lot?
A little.
Oh, that's it, yeah. Yeah, sometimes you don't know really, yeah, Hawaii, I mean, Hamburg to Hawaii, New York to Hawaii, connecting in New York, plus like one of the nice St. Louis and Milwaukee, $500. Just like, but. I don't think I never ever got really stuck on a flight, but just missed my connection, couldn't make anything. Usually, they make everything they can do to get you on the plane, because they know if you get stranded, they have to pay more money.
Most of the time, it's weather or mechanical that gets you. Things out of your control.
Isn't there also some other thing that if you use one of the first parts of your ticket is it can't be cancelled anymore?
It really depends on the fare rules. Sometimes you can cancel, sometimes you don't get the base fare back, but you get some of the surcharges.
I mean from the airline side. The airline side can cancel your ticket at the moment you show up. But as soon as you check in for the first time, they can't cancel the rest anymore?
Usually how actually this is the moment they charge you money on the credit card and you have a ticket number, like the 220 whatever ticket number you have on your boarding pass, the moment you have the ticket number, then the ticket is issued, and usually then you're good. Before, it can be that you just have a reservation for a seat, but the seat is not reconfirmed, or the ticket is not issued, they didn't take any money from you, just have a reservation. They can change, cancel, whatever, but if you have the ticket number, usually I would just print it as a PDF, and you're good. But I never had an airline cancel a ticket on me. This is an example, for instance, transatlantic flight, but issued in Australia, and back in the days, the exchange rate was like 2-1, so it's like 170 euros. Transatlantic, yeah. I've been to Chernobyl in a picture.
So
that's actually the South Africa's. They were start by that time. They were starting building the new one, and this is 4 microsievert.
Yeah.
Normal rate would be 0.1, 0.15, yeah. And the highest in the red flowers was like 25, which even made the blind internal minister, whatever guy that was accompanying us, a bit scary. Sometimes if you're just looking for fares, like a friend of mine needed segments to requalify instead of based on segments, not on like a number of flies, not on miles. And you just had to take flight, and it's like Hendrik from Paris, Paris to Milan, Rome to Venice, on Mondays, and go back just to collect miles. Every once in a while we're going on events, and I was lucky because in family I know somebody who works for Airbus. This is actually the tools they use to do all the bolting all the frames together from like the A380, and we could see all the tools, and it's really you can see how clean that stuff is. Yeah. We're allowed to go in the factory where they built the A380 in Hamburg and just look at all this stuff. That was kind of nice too. Yeah, that was a good fire talk. Yeah, that's creepy at the
Wow.
That thing.
It's
yeah. So if you're there was on the tour I was taking, there was one guy that was really into playing all these first person shooters. Like, oh, if I go in here and turn left, there should be this. They were pretty accurate. From F to C, but yeah, this is one of the trips that I booked, and I tried to book the third one of those tickets, and by that time it was already gone. But it's Minneapolis to
Spokane.
Yeah. $150, and the lowest economy fare, but somehow that went all the way to First Republic, $150. So if you have the choice, I mean, you fly first and you don't fly direct, you go Minneapolis, Charlotte, San Francisco. That's not even the full route. Just if you go further down, this all boils down to even more segments. And all in first class, $150. So that's all in one ticket. You actually max out the number of flights you can have on a single ticket.
Oh,
that's
nice.
The elimination. And then you go in the morning, you go to the, because you can see, it's all starting, what's one day, no? Yeah, 4th of April is like one day. Essentially you have like, it's a bit hard to get more than 6 flights on a single day. 4 flights is usually doable, but 6 flights is really tedious, and then you just try to like do a red-eye flight from like US West Coast to East Coast just to get back the next morning. You go to the you can check in for all the flights within like next 24 hours, and if your return flight is within 24 hours, you can also check in for that. So you go to the check-in agent and say, okay, I'm gonna pick up my tickets, and suddenly the ticket printer starts spitting out like 12, 30, 40 tickets. That's it's nice, yeah. One of the tickets going, yeah. That's about it. So if anybody wants to look at a certain fare, find something interesting, well, I'm around here to my flight is at 6 AM in the morning. So, yeah, very good.